I don't think there are many things that are discussed so passionately in my comment section as fragrance in skincare. Is it really the worst thing you can do? Will it contribute to skin aging? And who should avoid fragrant products at all costs? Let me take you through some numbers so you can make up your mind if or if not you want to avoid fragrance in your skincare products, because, spoiler, with a few exceptions, it is a personal decision rather than a rule based on hard facts. If you're new, you're welcome. I'm Dr. Anne, a physician passionate about skincare and well-aging. Fragrance is actually an umbrella term for a chemical mixture of organic compounds that has a distinct smell or odor, not always a pleasant one. Some people use it interchangeably to perfume, which is a liquid mixture formed from either fragrant essential oils or synthetic aromatic compounds used to emit a pleasant odor. So basically, a perfume can consist of fragrance, but not all fragrance is a perfume. That difference isn't actually that important for this video, though. What is important to know is that fragrance is not one defined substance, but a variety of around 2,800 different mixtures, out of which at least 100 are allergenic. This, as well as the trade secret protecting individual formulas, makes it harder to know which individual components you react to and how they can be avoided. If you're allergic to, let's say, glycerin, unlikely, I know, but if you were, you could look at the label and say, oh, contains glycerin, so not for me, or no glycerin, I can use it. If you react to fragrance, the fragrance on the label of the next product could cause a reaction, or it could be something else entirely you wouldn't know. Natural fragrance is what fragrant essential oils are referred to, as opposed to the synthetic compounds created in the lab. In terms of allergen potential, both are equal, with the exception that synthetic compounds contain a defined and reliable amount of substances, whereas the concentration and relation of the substances in essential oils can vary depending on the weather, the time of harvest, the extraction method. Basically, both are black boxes, but the natural version is even blacker. It is also possible to formulate the synthetic fragrance compounds in a way that is less likely to cause reactions. Another point for a synthetic, even if you don't take sustainability and availability into account. When you think about it, it is close to impossible to avoid fragrance in your daily life. And I'm not only talking about those people whose perfume cloud enters the room 20 minutes before they arrive. Seriously though, that is hell for migraine sufferers like myself. No, I am talking about the products we use in our everyday life, like household cleaning products, cosmetics, makeup, personal care items. Even female hygiene products are scented these days. So even if you prefer your skincare fragrance-free, it is basically everywhere else. It is important to note that there is a difference between fragrance-free and unscented when it comes to products. Fragrance-free means that there are no ingredients added whose purpose it is to add a smell. Some of these products do have quite a strong scent of their own, while unscented means that the product doesn't smell, but does not mean that no ingredients were added whose purpose it is to alter or mask a scent. Many products smell horrific on their own, so these masking scents are used to make them smell like nothing. A product with no scent may have more fragrance in it than one that smells quite strongly. And to add to this confusion, some ingredients are fragrant but also serve another purpose, meaning they can be added as, say, preservatives, but do also act as fragrance. Because they are not added solely for that purpose, though, the product still counts as fragrance-free. Confused? I totally get that. You will often hear that fragrance is very likely to absorb into the skin and disrupt hormones, trigger allergies, whatever. But while the reasoning that essential oils and synthetic fragrances as small oil-based molecules have a high likelihood to do that based on their physicochemical properties, it does leave out a few important things. First, the absorption of any substance into the skin does depend not only on the molecular structure, but also on the vehicle it is applied in, the concentration it comes in, and potential occlusion applied on top, just to name a few. Human skin is designed to act as a barrier, so it isn't easy to get things to penetrate. If it were, we'd need much less needles in medicine. And second, while you could design a product that would maximize fragrance absorption into the skin, the question is, why would you? The goal with fragrance products is not to get stuff into the body. The goal is to get the scent into your nose so it can trigger emotions and make you feel good. And to do that, the fragrant molecules need to evaporate from the skin, meaning the products are formulated in a way that they don't stay on the skin. They go up in the air, and what goes up in the air will not penetrate the skin. So while a small fraction will get into the body, it is probably less than it will be when you spritz yourself with perfume, and not enough to cause any problems. Now that we established that fragrance is not absorbed in the body in huge doses, it is easy to understand that it will not alter your hormones through that pathway either. Still, there's the subject of phthalates, a substance known to be able to affect hormone production after oral ingestion and used in fragrance to make the scent adhere to the skin for longer. Is this a problem? After all, there must be a reason why phthalate-free is slapped on every other product. The reason for that is marketing, the usual free from fear-mongering tactic to make you think the product you are looking at is superior to others. Phthalates used in skincare are used in such small doses and applied to the skin rather than ingested, they do not affect your body whatsoever. I mean, a pleasant scent can calm you down, can make you think of the hot person you met the night before, can take you back to your grandma's living room. All that will affect you, but not because of fragrance entering your bloodstream. When you look online, you can easily get the impression that a fragrance allergy is very common and will affect the majority of the adult population eventually. But that is not true. When you look at the results from patch testing, around 10% of people present with a fragrance allergy, compared to 20% presenting with a nickel allergy, very common in zippers and jewelry, for example. These 10% need to be put in perspective by taking into the consideration that we only test against a limited number of fragrant components. Remember, more than 2,800 are used, and in patch testing only fragrance mix 1, fragrance mix 2, and the balsam of Peru are tested, meaning 9 fragrant components in the first mix, 6 in the second mix, and then the black box that is balsam of Peru with more than 250 ingredients, out of which not all are identified. But even with that in the equation, we still only test a fraction of the possible triggers, meaning fragrance allergy could be underdiagnosed. At the same time, you need to look at where the data comes from. It is not random people on the streets, it is people visiting the dermatologist because they suffer from an allergy, meaning the actual number based on the general population is much lower. It is estimated that based on the general population, around 1% do have a fragrance allergy, which is not little, but way less than other allergies. We know that there are specific professions that are more likely to develop contact dermatitis to fragrant components, and interestingly enough, that is not people working in a perfume factory, but people like hairdressers that do handle a lot of fragrant products while at the same time compromising their skin barrier through keeping their hands immersed in water while washing the hair of their customers. Same is true for people with chronic eczema or atopic dermatitis. Their risk for having a fragrance allergy is higher, which is in part due to their allergic disposition. Many also have seasonal allergies or food allergies, but also due to their impaired skin barrier. And that is actually the main reason I would, and during some periods of my life, have avoided fragrance. A compromised skin barrier, not a little redness after overusing your actives again, we all have been there, but a flare-up of eczema, atopic dermatitis, or a chronic condition like rosacea. Another reason might be if you have a strong allergic disposition, meaning you are already reacting to a lot of foods, pollen and stuff like that. If that is you, trying to avoid other potential allergens could be a reasonable personal choice. Also, a great reason is, of course, simply because you want to. If the fragrance gives you headaches, if you don't like the oftentimes fluorescent products have, by all means, don't use them. There's no additional benefit other than the pleasant scent and the feeling of luxury and comfort that might evoke for you. Whatever your personal stance on fragrance and skincare is, you are free to choose to use or to avoid it. I personally enjoy it in my products, enjoy indulging in the scent of the product that makes me feel good, and do not fear any negative consequences from that. So, whatever your decision might be, you should not make it out of fear. Fragrance is not bad for your skin or your hormones. You should remember that natural isn't better, but oftentimes worse in terms of allergic potential, and that unscented is not the same as fragrance-free. Where do you stand on fragrance and skincare? Please tell me in the comments below. I will link to more videos you might find interesting on the screen, and links to my Instagram, blog, and Patreon account in the description box. See you soon, bye!